Today's session, we are going to see about masonry construction. I am Dr. Sophie, Associate Professor, Department of Structural and Geotechnical Engineering, School of Civil and Chemical Engineering, VIT University. Walls designed to carry superimposed load in addition to their own weights is termed as load-bearing walls. There are two different types of load-bearing walls, external load-bearing wall and internal load-bearing wall. Non-load-bearing walls that cannot withstand superimposed load and only can support their own weight is termed as non-load-bearing walls. An interior load-bearing wall provided to divide the space within the building is termed as partition walls. Masonry walls can be built of bricks, stones, concrete, and it can be cemented or bonded together with mortar. There are different types of masonry construction: stone masonry, brick masonry, hollow block masonry, reinforced and composite masonry. Stones are cut and dressed to the proper shape. The bond material used for this stone masonry is either lime mortar or cement mortar. The following are the application of stone masonry: building foundations, dams, monumental structures, walls, piers, arches, domes, etc. The following are the tools for stone masonry: trowel, plumber broom, split level, pickaxe, crowbar, iron hammer, gouge and wedge. Dressing of stones. Process of making the stone surfaces fit for construction work is known as dressing of stones. Dressing can be done manually by using hammers, sizzle or by machines. The following are the stages of dressing: sizing, shaping, planing, finishing and polishing. The two different classification of stone masonry are as follows: rubble masonry and ashlar masonry. Rubble masonry, again, it can be classified into six different types: uncoarse rubble, coarse random, coarse square, polygonal, flint and dry rubble. Uncoarse rubble masonry, the stones used in this type vary in their shape and size. Interior wall filled with chips or mortar. Thickness of joint is not more than 13 mm. The types of uncoarse rubble masonry are uncoarse random rubble and uncoarse square rubble. Uncoarse random rubble, the vertical joints not constructed using plumber. In this one, bigger stone blocks are used. The following sketch shows the uncoarse random rubble type of masonry. Uncoarse square rubble, stone blocks made roughly as squares with hammer. Varying sizes placed in irregular pattern. Facing stones or hammer dressed more uniform in the joints. Large size of stones are used as quoins. Stones are used in corner is a type of stone which will be calling it as quoins. Coarse random rubble masonry are used in low height of public buildings, abutments and piers. Stones of 5 cm to 20 cm sizes are used. Stones of equal heights are used in every course. Joint thickness can be 1.5 cm. Stones of 2 to 3 numbers may place one above another to maintain same height. Coarse square rubble masonry or the type of stones used are hammered. In the courses, each are of same height. Height can be reduced in upper portion of wall. To avoid thick mortar joints, chips can be used. The following sketch shows the coarse square rubble masonry. Polygonal rubble masonry is a type of masonry in which stones are roughly polygonal in shape. Stones are arranged to avoid long vertical joints. The sketch shows the polygonal type of masonry. Flint rubble masonry. Flint stones of 8 cm to 15 cm and of length 15 to 30 cm in size can be used. Buildings in coastal areas, the rounder type of lengths procured from beaches are used as a stones in this type of masonry. Dry rubble masonry. In retaining wall, pitching up dams, canal slopes, dry rubble masonries are used. The difference between the remaining masonry and the dry rubble is, in this, the stones are tightly packed, left without using the mortar as the bond. The following sketch shows the dry rubble masonry. The next type of masonry is ashlar. It can be again classified into ashlar fine, ashlar rough tooled, ashlar rock, ashlar chamfered and ashlar facing. Ashlar fine. Stones are dressed perfectly, sizes of stones are regular. Courses should not be less than 300 mm in a height. Width should not be less than height of course. Face stones are like headers and stretchers alternatively. Joints are made with fine mortar. The following sketch shows the ashlar fine. Ashlar rough tool. Size of stones bonds are similar to ashlar fine. Exposed faces are fine dressed by chisel drafting of about 25 mm. In between drafts, portions are roughly tooled. Ashlar rock. The type of ashlar rock. Exposed faces of facing stones are all around or left undressed. Projections of size more than 8 cm are broken. The following sketch shows the ashlar type of rock. Ashlar chamfer. Exposed edges of stones are beveled for a depth of about 2.5 cm. Ashlar facing. It's a type in which the facing is ashlar masonry and backing is of brick masonry. It's a composite type of arrangement. Height of course should not be more than 200 mm. The figure shows the ashlar facing type of masonry. In this session, we are going to see about brick masonry. Brick masonry constructions can be used for different types of buildings. It can also be used for footpaths. This is a temple, old age temple, in which bricks has been used as a wall. This is also an olden temple in Suzdal city, which is located in Russia. The following are some of the important terms in which we have to see while brick masonry has been carried out. Header. The brick which is laid in a way that only the shorter end is visible. Stretcher. It's a brick laid in a way that allows only the longer side of the brick to be exposed. Bed. It's a lower surface of the brick when laid flat. Bed joint. It's a horizontal layer of mortar. The horizontal distance between the vertical joints in successive courses is known as lap. Closer, it's a piece of brick used to close up the bond. It can be again named as queen closer and king closer. Cutting brick longitudinally is known as queen closer. Cutting triangular portion of brick is known as king closer. The broken pieces of bricks are known as brick bats. The different types of bricks bonding are stretcher bond, header bond, English bond, Flemish, English garden wall, racking, herringbone bond and common American bond. Stretcher bond. It's the easiest type to lay and minimizes the amount of cutting required. Originally used for single brick walls, now called one end of brick wall or half brick wall, it becomes the choice for cavity walls as less cutting was required. Bricks are arranged in header courses, which it is known as header bond. Brick bats are used in each alternative courses as quoins. It's not suitable for load bearing walls. English bond. Alternative poses of headers and stretchers in which one header placed centrally above each other. This is a very strong bond when the wall brick is one brick or one end of brick or two brick wall or two end of brick wall. It's named as one of the strongest brick bond pattern when compared to other. Flemish bond. Alternate bricks are placed as header and stretcher in every course. Each header is placed centrally between the stretcher immediately above and below. This is not as strong as the English bond at one brick thick. English garden wall bond. An alternative version of English bond with header courses being inserted at every fourth or sixth course. This is a weaker bond and suitable for garden wall or compound wall. Racking bond. In this bond, courses are inclined. Inclination is in opposite direction in alternate courses. A course with racking bond is provided at regular interval of 4 to 8 courses. Herringbone bond. It's a purely decorative bond. It's used in floor and wall panels. Common or American bond. A brickwork pattern in which all rows are stretchers except an eighth row is of header. Hollow brick masonry. It can be used suitable for low cost house construction. It's manufactured by using 60% fine aggregate and 40% of 6 to 12 mm size coarse aggregate. The mix ratio is of 1:6 cement to aggregate. Strength of block is 30 kg per centimeter square. The various sizes of hollow block masonry are 39 by 19 by 30 cm, 39 by 19 by 20 cm and 39 by 19 by 10 cm. The following are some of the common concrete blocks used in building construction. The figure shows the procedure how the hollow block has been placed in the site. Pointing. Finishing of mortar joints in exposed brick or stone masonry using cement mortar or lime mortar is known as pointing. To protect the joints from weather effects, it is used. To improve the appearance of building structure, it's used. The following are the operations involved in pointing. Masonry face joints are ragged out to a depth of about 15 mm. Loose mortar and dust are removed by brushes. The joints on the wall surface are washed and cleaned with clean water and kept wet for a few hours. The spaces so formed are then filled by suitable mortar mix with using small trowel. Finished pointing work is kept for 3 days for lime mortar and 10 days for cement mortar. The following sketch shows how the pointing has been done in the site. Plastering. Plastering is a process of covering rough walls and uneven surfaces in the construction with a plastic material which it's plaster or mortar. The main objective of the plastering are to make the surface even, smooth, clean and durable. It's also preserve and protect the surface from atmospheric influence. Conceal defective workmanship. Base for whitewashing. The following are the different types of plaster: lime plaster or mortar, cement plaster or mortar, mud plaster or waterproof plaster. The some of the tools used for plastering are trowel, wooden float, floating rule and plumber. Brick. It's a rectangular block of clay backed by the sun or knuckling used as a building or paving material. The following are the constituents of brick: alumina, silica, lime, oxides and magnesia. The presence of all the ingredients is between the range in which if it exceeds will affect the quality of the brick. Alumina. The presence of alumina is about 20% to 30%. It imparts plasticity to clay for easy molding. Excess presence of alumina produces cracks on brick. Silica. The presence of silica is about 50% to 60%. It prevents cracking, shrinking, warping of bricks. It imparts shape to the bricks. Durability of bricks depends on presence of silica. Excess destroys the cohesion between particles and the brick become brittle. Presence of lime. Less than 10% is desirable. Prevents shrinkage. Excess causes the brick to melt and brick lost its shape. Oxides of iron. 5 to 6% of iron content is desirable. It imparts red color to bricks. Excess makes the brick dark blue or blackish in color. Less impart yellow in color. Magnesia. Less than 1% is desirable. Exceeding 1% impart yellow color. It reduces shrinkage and excess cast decay of bricks. The harmful ingredients in briquette are the following: iron pyrites, alkalis, pebbles, organic matter and carbonaceous materials. Iron pyrites tend to oxidize and decompose the brick during burning, split into pieces. Alkalis present greater than 10% of alkali combined with silicates of alumina make clay unsuitable for bricks. On drying, moisture evaporates, leaving gray or white powder deposits that spoil brick appearance. The phenomena is termed as efflorescence. Organic matter during burning. If organic matter not burned properly, bricks become porous, water absorption increase and strength decrease. Carbon affects the color of the brick. The following are the operations involved during manufacturing process of bricks: preparation of clay, molding, drying and burning. Preparation of clay. Unsoiling. The top layer of soil about 200 mm in depth is taken out since top is full of impurities. Digging. Clay is dug out from the ground and spread it on the ground. The height of clay is about 600 mm to 1200 mm. Cleaning. Clay obtained from digging should be cleaned off from stones, pebbles, vegetable matter, etc. Lumps of clay should be converted to powder form using earth crushing roller. Weathering. Clay is then exposed to atmosphere for softening. Period of exposure is about few weeks or in a month. Blending. Clay is then added with ingredients such as calcareous earth and mix it thoroughly. Moderate amount of water is added to get proper consistency. Excess water affects the size and shape of finished brick. Tempering. In this process, clay is brought to a proper degree of hardness. Whole mass of clay is pressed and kneaded under the feet to obtain homogeneous mass of clay. Pug mill. For tempering large scale, pug mill is used. Process of grinding clay with water and making it plastic is known as pugging. It consists of a conical iron tube with cover at its top. It has timber base with a hole to take out the mixed clay. Bottom diameter of pug mill is 800 mm and top is 1 meter. To place clay inside, the pug mill provision is made at the top. Vertical shaft with horizontal arm is provided at the center of iron tub. Small wedge-shaped knives of steel are fixed on horizontal arms. Vertical shaft is connected to a long arm. At the bottom, ramp is provided to collect the pug clay. Clay with water is placed in the pug mill from the top. The vertical shaft is rotated and the clay is thoroughly mixed up by action of horizontal arms and knives. Mixing is thoroughly done to get a homogeneous mass. Shaft rotation can also be done by using electric power or steam. The clay after pug is collected from the ramp provided at the bottom. The following figure shows the pug mill. Molding. It's a next operation after tempering. It can be divided into either hand molding or machine molding. Hand molding. Bricks molded manually adapted where manpower is cheap also for manufacturing bricks in small scale. Molds are of rectangular boxes of wood or steel which are open at top and bottom. Brick shrink during drying and burning, so the molds should be made longer, about 8% to 12%. Bricks prepared by ground molding and table molding. The following are the two standard sizes of bricks: 190 mm by 90 mm by 90 mm and 200 mm by 100 mm by 100 mm. Ground molded bricks. Ground is made level and fine shaped sand is sprinkled over it. Mold is dipped in water and placed over the ground. Clay is pressed in the mold so that it fills all corners of mold. Extra clay is removed by wooden strike. The mold is lifted up and raw brick is left on the ground. Mold is dipped in water and placed near the previous brick to prepare next. Repeat the process. 8 hours, 750 bricks can be manufactured. After drying, they are carried out to drying shed. Wooden block. Design of impression or frog is made on this block. The impression indicates the trade name of the manufacturer. Table molded bricks. In this type of brick, the table of size 2 meter by 1 meter is used. Machine molding bricks can be manufactured by using two different types of machines: plastic clay machines and dry clay machines. Plastic clay machines are the type in which a rectangular opening of equal size of bricks can be manufactured. Pugged clay is placed in the machine as it comes out through the opening, in which the type of brick produced by this type can be named as wire cut bricks. Dry clay machines. Strong clay is converted to powder form. Water is added in small quantity to form a stiff plastic paste. Place the paste in mold and press by machine to form well-shaped bricks. Bricks are known as pressed bricks. Directly sent process of burning. The following are some of the advantages of machine molding bricks: regular shape, sharp edges and corners, smooth external surface, heavier and stronger, uniform dense structure. The next process is drying. Bricks are laid longitudinally in stacks of width equal to bricks. Bricks are laid along and cross topped in alternate layers, drying for about 3 to 10 days. Air circulation should be there. Drying order is prepared at higher level to prevent accumulation of rainwater. To avoid direct exposure of sun, screens can be used. Artificial drying are allowed to pass through hot channels or floors. In hot channel, temperature is less than 120 degree. In drying can be made for about 1 to 3 days. Burning imparts hardness and strength to bricks. Overburned bricks will become brittle. Unburned bricks will become soft and cannot carry loads. Burning of bricks is done in clamps or in kilns. Clamps can be made by means in which we'll be calling it as temporary structure. Select suitable ground. Its shape in plan is trapezoidal. Brick wall in mud is constructed on the short end and a layer of fuel is laid on the prepared floor. The fuel consists of grass, wood, cow dung, rice husk, etc. Thickness of the layer is 700 mm to 800 mm. Layer of raw bits are laid with small spaces between them for air circulation. Second layer of fuel is placed and another layer of raw bricks. Thickness of fuel decreases as height of clamp increases. Total height is about 3 to 4 meter. The fuel in the lower layer is fired to prevent the escape of heat. The clamp is completely plastered with mud on sides and top. Burn it for 1 to 2 months. Allow it to cool for same period. The permanent structure can be called as kilns. It's a large oven used to burn bricks. There are two different types of kilns, intermittent kilns and continuous kilns. Intermittent kilns are in which bricks are loaded, fired, cooled and unloaded. It's rectangular or circular in plan. Intermittent updrawn kilns, the wide doors are open are provided at each end for loading and unloading of kilns. Channels or passages are provided to carry flames or hot gases through the body of kiln. Temporary roof of light material is made to give protection from rain. Continuous kilns. Kilns of continuous in operation, loading, firing, cooling and unloading are carried out simultaneously. There are different types of continuous kilns: Bullstrunch, Hoffman's and Tunnel. The figure shows the Bullstrunch kiln in which the operation is continuously carried out. Section 1 for loading, section 2 is for empty and section 3 for unloading. Section 4, the cooling process can be carried out. In section 5, the burning process can be carried out and in section 6, heating can be carried out. The following figure shows the Hoffman's kiln in which it can be divided into number of chambers. Chamber 1 is for loading, chamber 2 to 5 drying and preheating process can be carried out, chamber 6 and 7 burning process can be carried out, chamber 8 to 11 cooling and chamber 12 unloading process can be carried out. The following sketch shows the permanent structure in which burning of bricks can be carried out. This is again the temporary structure. This is the loading of the brick for small scale production. The following are the tests in which has been carried out for bricks. Absorption test. Weight of brick is taken in dry condition. Immerse it for 16 hours. The difference in weight indicates the absorption of brick. It should not exceed 20%. Compression strength, or it can be called as crushing strength. Minimum crushing strength should be 3.5 Newton per mm square as per Indian standard code. Grade A bricks can be the value ranging from 7 to 14 Newton per mm square. Grade A brick can be compressive strength greater than 14 Newton per mm square. Bricks are tested under compression testing machine in which load is applied. Load per cross-sectional area will give you the crushing strength of the brick. Hardness stress can be measured by means of making a scratch on the brick surface with nail. Brick is sufficiently hard if no impression is left. Presence of soluble salts can be measured by immersing the brick in water for 24 hours. Take it out and dry it. No gray or white deposit indicates absence of soluble salts. White deposits found 10% efflorescence is light. 50% presence is represent the brick has moderate presence of soluble salts. If the presence was greater than 50%, heavy presence of soluble salts was there. Soundness. Struck two bricks each other, it should not break. A clear sound should be produced. In this session, we'll see about roofing materials, steel and aluminium. A building material classified on the basis of carbon content. It can be classified into mild steel, dead mild steel, medium carbon steel and high carbon steel. If the percentage ranging from 0.15% to 0.3% of carbon content, it's named as mild steel. If the carbon content less than 0.15%, it's dead melt steel. Medium carbon steel, if the percentage content 0.3 to 0.8%. High carbon steel, if the percentage 0.8 to 1.5%, it's named as high carbon steel. There are different types of manufacturing process of steel: Bessemer process, cementation, crucible, duplex, electrical process and open hearth process. Bessemer process: it's wide at bottom and narrow at top, mounted on two horizontal trunnions for tilting or rotating. To allow passage of air, pig iron tires are provided at the bottom. Converter is tilted and it is charged with molten pig iron from the surface. Converter is brought in an upright position, then hot air is forced through tires. It oxidizes impurities of pig iron within 10 to 15 minutes. When the flame is reduced, blast is shut off and add suitable material as ferromanganese etc. to make steel. The following figure shows the Bessemer process. Cementation process: bars of pure wrought iron are placed in the dome-shaped furnace known as cementation furnace. Furnace is heated for 5 to 15 days to get better quality of steel rakia. Wrought iron combines with carbon. Steel of desired composition is formed. Steel formed is covered with blister or thin bubble. The steel is known as blister steel. Crucible steel process: in this, blister steel or wrought iron is taken and mixed with charcoal. They are placed in fire clay crucibles and heated. Molten iron is poured into suitable molds. Steel produced by this process is known as cast steel. Electric process: a circular or rectangular electric furnace is used. It's lined with refractory material, mounted on rollers for tilting, provided with electrodes. Electric arcs are formed when electric current is switched on. Prepare special steel on small scale. Open hearth process: in this process, open hearth furnace is filled with molten pig iron. Mixture of preheated air and coal gas is allowed to pass over the hearth. Due to intense heat, impurities of metal oxidize. After removal of impurities, suitable material such as ferromanganese are added to make steel. Duplex process: it's a combination of Bessemer and open hearth process. Impurities are removed from Bessemer converter and further treated in open hearth to remove the impurities. The following are the forms of steel: angle section, channel, I section, T section, corrugated sheets, flat bars, expanded metal plates, ribbed tall steel bars, rounded bars and square bars. The following are the mechanical treatment of steel: drawing, forging, pressing and rolling. To reduce cross section and to increase the length, the drawing operation is involved. Metal is drawn through dies. Drawing is continued to get required shape. Forging: power hammer is used to give repeated blows to the metal. Metal is heated before giving blows. This operation increases density and improves grain size of metal. Slow process and is carried out in press, which is known as pressing. Press consists of die and a punch. Die and punch are suitably shaped to get article of desired shape. Metal is placed on the die and punch under heavy pressure, desired shape is obtained. Operation is carried out in rolling mills. Red hot metals are passed through different rollers to get desired shapes like channels, angles, etc. Jointless pipe also obtained by this process. The following are the heat treatment. Process in which heating and cooling of steel changes its structural and physical properties is known as heat treatment. Annealing, case hardening, cementing, cyaniding, hardening, nitriding, normalizing and tempering are the following heat treatment. Annealing: to make steel soft to work easily with a machine. Annealing reduces tensile strength, it increases ductility. Steel to be annealed is heated to desired temperature. Temperature depends upon carbon content in which it has been indicated in Table 1. After heated, steel is allowed to cool slowly in the furnace. If the carbon content was less than 0.12%, the annealing temperature is in the range of 871 to 925. If the carbon content was in the range of 0.14% to 0.29%, the annealing temperature was in the range of 843 to 870. Case ordinal. Specimen placed in carburizing mixture for 900 degree to 950 degree Celsius for 6 to 8 hours. Quenched directly from the box at carburizing mixture. Cool it slowly in box and reheat it. Cool it in box and again reheat twice and cool it. Specimen remains tough and ductile, and further the specimen became hard. Cementing. Skin of steel is saturated with carbon. Heating steel in a carbon-rich medium at 880 degrees Celsius to 950 degrees Celsius. Cyaniding. Adding carbon and nitrogen to the surface layer of steel to increase hardness, wear resistance and fatigue limit. Heated to 950 degrees Celsius, followed by water or oil quenching. Nitriding. The process of saturating surface layer of steel with nitrogen by heating is known as nitriding. Steel is heated in atmosphere of ammonia at a temperature of 480 degrees Celsius to 650 degrees Celsius. Thick of nitriding layer is 0.01 to 1 mm. To restore steel structure in normal condition, normalizing process is involved. It's heated for 40 to 50 degrees Celsius for short duration and allowed to cool at room temperature. Steel after hardening must be tempered since hardened steel is brittle. Low temperature tempering should be in the range of 150 degrees Celsius to 200 degrees Celsius. Medium temperature is in the range of 350 to 400. High temperature tempering should be in the range of 500 to 600. Extraction of aluminium. The figure shows how the aluminium has been extracted. The steel container is coated with carbon and this is negative electrode. Electrolysis of aluminium solution gives aluminium at the cathode and oxygen at the anode. Aluminium is more dense than the alumina cryolate solution and so falls at the bottom of the sill where it can be tapped off as pure liquid metal. The overall reaction is shown below. Oxygen is discharged at the positive carbon. The carbon anode slowly reacts to make carbon dioxide and needs to be replaced regularly. The following are the properties of aluminium: good conductor of heat and electricity, non-magnetic substance, light in weight, malleable and ductile, possess toughness and tensile strength. The specific gravity is 2.70. The following are the characteristics of aluminium: air tightness perfectly, appearance, cryogenics, easy in fabrication and assembly, handling and transport cost, high corrosion resistance, high reflectivity, high scrap value, high strength to weight ratio, maintenance cost, noise control. The following are the two different roofing materials that can be used: asbestos cement sheets, galvanized iron sheets. Cement is mixed with 15% of asbestos fibers and the paste is pressed under rollers with grooves. AC sheets are with series of waves or corrugations. It's used in factories, workshops, garages, etc. Corrugations increases strength and rigidity, fire resistance, light in weight and soundproof. The following figure shows AC sheet. Galvanized iron sheets prepared by pressing wrought iron plates between rollers with grooves and galvanized with a coat of zinc. Galvanizing name from galvanized scientist. Corrugations help to increase strength and rigidity, permit easy flow of rainwater. The length range from 1.2 meter to 3.6 meter. width range from 600 mm to 800 mm, sorry, width range from 600 to 900, thickness ranges from 0.18 to 1.6 mm, costly, do not offer resistance to fire and sound. The figure shows the GI sheets. The next topic we'll be seeing on about timber. Timber is a building material with properties as low heat conductivity, less density, high strength. Classification of trees goes on like this: exogenous, endogenous. Characteristics of good timber: appearance, hard and shining. Its color, dark in color or maybe light color, which indicates low strength. Defects: it should be free from dead knots, shakes. Durability: it should be durable. Elasticity: fibers, hardness, mechanical wear, should not deteriorate due to mechanical wear or abrasion. Shape: it should not warp. Smell: unpleasant smell indicates decayed smell. Sound: it should be clear. Strength: weathering effect. And weight: the following are the different varieties of timber which is used in industries: veneers, plywoods, fiberboards, impact timbers and compact timbers. Thin sheets are slices of woods of superior quality. Thickness is of 0.40 to 6 mm. It's obtained by rotating a log of wood against sharp knife of rotatory cutter. They are dried in cleansed to remove moisture. Veneers: thin sheets are slices of woods of superior quality. Thickness is of ranging from 40 mm to 6 mm, obtained by rotating a log of wood against sharp knife of rotatory cutter. Sheets used for preparing decorative sheets. Process of preparing sheets of veneers is called veneering. The type of trees used for this purpose is rosewood, oak, teak, etc. Plywood. Ply is a thin layer. Plywood or boards prepared from thin layers of oats or veneers. Three or more veneers are placed by suitable adhesives. Placing of veneers normal to each other increase a longitudinal and transverse strength of plywood. After glue, pressure is applied either hot or cold. Hot pressure by hydraulic press. Temperature is 150 degree to 260 degree Celsius. For cold pressure, pressed at room temperature. The pressure varies from 0.7 to 1.4 Newton per mm square. Plywoods are used for ceilings, doors, furniture, walls. Forms of plywood are batten board, lamin board, metal face, free plywoods. Batten board: a solid block with core of sawn wood thickness 20 mm to 25 mm. Total thickness is 50 mm. Boards are light and strong. Used for making partition wall, ceiling shutters of doors and windows. The following picture shows the plywoods. Batten board. Lamin board is similar to batten board except core is made of multi-ply veneers. Thickness ranging from 6 mm and total thickness is 50 mm. External plies are of thick veneers and are firmly glued with core to form a solid block. Plywoods prepared from the three plies only are known as three plywood. Plies are placed at right angles to each other. The main advantages of plywoods are: as plies are placed at right angle to each other, the expansion and shrinkage are very low. Available in variety of decorative appearance. Available in large sizes. They are elastic and they are not liable to split or crack due to temperature changes. Light in weight, not easily affected by moisture. Fiberboards. They are rigid boards known as pressed wood. Thickness varies from 3 mm to 12 mm. Available in lengths varying from 1.2 meter to 1.8 meter. Weight of fiber boards depends on the pressure applied. Maximum and minimum limits of weights are 9600 Newton per meter cube and 500 to 600 Newton per meter cube. The procedure of manufacture of fiber boards are: pieces of woods, fibers, chippings, etc. are collected and heated and boiled in a hot water boiler. Wood fibers separated by heat are put in a vessel. Steam under pressure is admitted in the vessel. Pressure of steam increased to 7 Newton per mm square. It's maintained for a few seconds. Valve at bottom is open and steam is allowed to expand. Sudden release makes the wooden pieces to explode and natural adhesive in wooden fiber is separated out. Wood fibers are then allowed to float and such loose sheets are prepared between steel plates to get fiber boards. The following are the uses of fiber boards: internal finish of rooms such as walls, wall paneling, ceilings, partitions, tops of tables, insulating material of heat and sound. Impact timbers. Timber with fully or partly covered with resin is known as impact timber. Veneered or thin strips of wood are taken and are immersed in resin. Resin fills a space between wood cells and by chemical reaction a consolidated mass develops. It is then cured at a room temperature of about 150 degree to 160 degree. The following are the advantages of impact timber. Strong and durable, possess more electric insulation. Compact timber. Process of preparing is same as impact except curing is carried out under pressure. Strength and durability are more as compared to impact. Specific gravity is about 1.3 to 1.35. Roof and roof coverings. Roof is the uppermost part of a building, supported on structural members and covered with a roofing material. Roof components. Roof deck. A flat or sloping in which roof covering is applied. It includes roof planks, rafters, purlins, joists, supporting members such as girders, trusses and rigid frames. A covering material provided over roof deck is known as roof coverings. Examples of roof coverings are shingles, tiles, asbestos, cement sheets and GI sheets. The different types of roofs are pitched or sloping roof, flat roof or terrace, shell or curved roof and domes. Pitched roof. Sloping decks that cover the building structure. Types of pitched roof. Shed roof or lean-to roof slopes in one direction. Cable roof. Roof slopes in two directions. The slope range from 1 in 3 to 1 in 1, 1 vertical and 3 horizontal. The following figure shows the shed or lean-to roof which slopes in one direction. Hip roof. Roof slopes in four directions. Gabriel roof. Roof slopes in two directions but there is a break in the slope. Flat roof. Roof which is flat, a slope in 1 in 24 or 1 in 6 is provided for proper drainage. Shell roof. Three-dimensional structure consists of thin slab membrane curved in one or more direction that transfer load on points of support. The following sketch shows the curved roof or shell roof. The following are the important technical terms. Ridge. It's the apex line of a sloping roof. Ridge beam. A wooden piece or board that runs horizontally at the apex. A common rafter is an inclined wooden member supporting the roof covering. Lower edge of the inclined roof from which the rainwater from roof surface drops down is known as eaves. Eaves board. A wooden board fixed to the feet of the common rafter which is of 15 to 20 cm wide and 20 to 25 cm thick. Battens. A thin strips of wood fixed on the common rafter to support the roofing material. A horizontal or steel members laid on principal rafter to support common rafter is known as purlin. The following figure shows the ridge beam, rafters and hanging beams. Again the figure shows the purlins, the inclined member rafters, roof covering, ceiling binders, ceiling joists. The figure shows the ridge pole, king post, cross beam and the material thatch which has been placed above the truss member, that's a roofing material. The figure shows the steel truss. Sloping or pitched roof. It can be classified into single roofs, purlin roof and framed roof. The following are the classification of single roof. Lean-to roof, couple closed roof, collar beam roof. Common rafters made to slope upwards from the opposite walls and are supported by ridge board is known as couple roof. Couple closed roof. Tie beam is provided to close the legs of the common rafter. Tie beam is of wood or steel rod in tension. Tie is raised up from the feet of the rafter or in the middle of the rafter as shown in the figure. Collar beam is fixed to 1 by 3rd to 1 by 2 of vertical height from wall to the ridge. Purlin roof or may be called as tie and collar roof. Additional members called purlins are provided to support the common rafter. The following are the different types of framed roofs. King post truss, queen post, combination of king post and queen post, mansard roof truss, truncated, bowstring or latticed roof truss. The following figure shows the king post truss. Span varying from 5 to 9 meter. King post prevents the tie beam from sagging at its center. Struts or brace support centers of the principal rafter. Principal rafter and struts act as compression member. Tie beam and king post act as tension member. Rafters and purlins are designed to carry transverse stresses. All joints are designed to carry intended stresses. Bottom of principal rafter is jointed to 1 inch of the tie beam by brittle joint or oblique mortise joint, further strengthened by bolt passing through the beam and rafter. The sketch shows the bolting connections. Queen post truss. Span of 9 to 14 meter range in which the queen post truss can be used. Two wood vertical members called queen post are provided to prevent sagging in the tie beam. As shown in the figure, two horizontal straining beam are used and two vertical posts, which is called as queen post, are used in the truss member. Truss consists of two principal rafter, strut, tie beam, straining beam, purlin, etc. Straining beams are provided to keep the upper ends of queen post in position. Straining steel to counteract the thrust of struts. Queen post tie beam is in tension. Rafter, straining beam and straining steel are also in tension. Combinations of king post and queen post. For spans greater than 14 meter, the king post is further modified by using upright members, which is called princess post. The figure shows the mansard roof truss. It has been named after the architect called Francois Mansard. The truss has two pitches or slopes. The lower slope varies from 60 to 75 degree. Upper slope varies from 30 to 40 degree. Lower portion is of a queen post model and upper portion is of a king post model. Truncated truss, similar to mansard except the flat top is flat. Belfast roof truss, or it may also called as bowstring truss. Truss in the form of bow, it may also called bowstring or latticed roof truss. Made up of thin sections of timber, used for spans up to 30 meter, provided with light roofing material. Central rise is of about 1/8 of the span. Composite roof truss, truss made of combination of different material like steel, wood, iron, etc. is termed as composite roof truss. Steel is used as tensile member. Principal rafter used in timber material which have greater compressive strength. Steel sloping roof truss. Steel trusses are economic for greater span of about 12 meter. Fabrication can be done for different shapes, free from attack of white ants and dry rot. Stronger than the timber, greater resistance against fire. No span restriction for steel truss. Erection of steel truss from rolled section is easy and rapid. The following sketch shows the steel truss. This session will see about sound insulation. Sound insulation is the prevention of transmission of sound. It's used to indicate the reduction uptime when sound passes from one room to another. Sound absorption, it's a prevention of a reflection of sound waves. There are two different classification of noises. One is outdoor and another one is indoor. Unwanted sound is noise. The classification of noises are due to airborne, structure borne, maybe due to through moving of furniture and drilling of machines. Transmission loss, it's a reduction in the sound intensity which denoted by capital T dot L. The difference between the decibel is known as transmission loss. Say for example, in a particular room the decibel is of 80 and another room the decibel is of 40. The difference between the two is known as transmission loss. The maximum acceptable noise level has been classified based upon the standard type of building and the noise level in decibel. Studios from radio, broadcasting and TV, the decibel range from 25 to 30. In auditoriums, the decibel range from 35 to 40. In small offices, the range is 40 to 45. Schools, the range is 45 to 50. Residential building, the range may be of 45 to 55 decibel. Sound insulation between individual room as per IS 1952, it has been It has been mentioned as between living room in one house, that maximum decibel is 50. Between houses, it's 40. Between one room and another, it's 30. Between teaching room, the decibel is 40. In office rooms, it's 30. The different constructive measures of noise control and sound insulations are vertical barriers, horizontal barriers, windows and doors, insulating sanitary fittings, machine mounting or insulation of masonry, in which the vertical barrier and the horizontal barriers may be walls and partitions and floors and ceilings. Walls and partitions. Wall acts as a vertical barrier in the transmission of sound. The material can be rigid and massive homogeneous partitions. Sound insulation of a partition increases with the increase in thickness, but it's not economical to increase beyond the limit. Partition of porous material. Porous concrete, sinter concrete, sound insulation increases 10% higher than the non-porous material. Particles of mineral wool, quilt offer very low sound insulation. Rigid panel insulation made from fibers material or from plastic foam. They are sometimes sold in sections designed to fit tightly to standard wall cavities. The sketch shows a rigid panel insulation. Insulated concrete foams are hollow, light in weight, foams made up of two expanded polystyrene, which is denoted by capital EPS, panels, which are connected by polypropylene webs. During construction, the foams are stacked to the desired height and then filled with concrete, making stable, durable and sustainable walls. The figure shows the structural insulated panels, also called stressed skin walls, use the same concept as in foam external doors, but extended the concept of the entire house. They can be used for ceilings, floors, walls and roofs. The panel consists of plywood sandwiched around a core of expanded polystyrene or polyurethane. Bat insulation or pre-cut virus blankets are available in continuous rolls. The figure shows the placement of bat insulation in the door. Components of bat and blanket insulation. Fiberglass is a material made from extremely fine fibers of glass, made from molten glass, usually with 20% to 30% recycled materials and post-consumer content. Rock and slag wool, usually made from basalt rock, diabase or iron ore blast furnace slag. Some rock wool contains recycled glass, which is of non-inflammable. Reflective insulation consists of two layers of 99% aluminium foil laminated to the outsides of two sheets of heavy-duty polyethylene air bubble cushioning. The figure shows the reflective insulating material. In floors and ceilings, which it's called as horizontal barriers, different types of resilient materials are used, such as linoleum, insulation board, cork, asphalt, mastic, carpet. Providing a floating floor construction is also a good solution for insulating material. An additional floating floor made to rest over the existing floor by means of resilient material like glass, wool, rubber, etc., so that sounds and vibrations are not transmitted to a room below. The figure shows how the insulating material has been placed at the floor level. This is a floor ceiling in which the above the floor air floor has been provided by means of inserting the quilt material. Concrete flooring. Concrete floor with flooring concrete screed, a layer of 1:1.5:3 of 5 cm thick resisting on a resilient layer of mineral wood quilt. Wood quilt is covered with waterproof paper to prevent wet concrete running through it. Concrete floor with floating wooden raft. Wooden bat 5 cm by 5 cm is laid over 2 cm thick resilient quilt. The figure shows how it has been placed. The figure shows how the false ceiling has been provided at the floor level. Concrete floor with suspended ceiling, concrete floor with lightweight concrete, or it can be heavy concrete with soft floor finish of resilient material like carpets, quilts and linoleum. To reduce vibration, increase the thickness or make the floor heavy. Floating floor consists of floorboards nailed to battens which resist on the resilient quilt. Use of suspended ceiling with air space, false independent ceiling is connected to the wooden floor by means of metal hangers, acoustic clip, etc. with space between them. In windows and doors, the solution in which can be act as insulated is provision of glassed window with double or triple panels of glass. Spacing between them is 20 cm. For doors, either increasing weight or any sound absorbing material in the space between the jamb and the frame. For refrigerators, lifts, machines should be insulated by resisting them on resilient supports or mounting on steel springs, rubber and cork. Thank you.